Okay, good morning, children.
Good morning.
How are you all? Good morning. How are you all?
Fine.
Okay, those who are taking seminar today, are you ready? Marin? Yes, right. Then Aditya Dev?
No, ma'am, I'm preparing the PPT.
Okay. Then what about Abhinav? Abhinav, are you there? No? Okay, Maharin, so you can present it now.
Okay.
What's about your topic?
Photoelectric effect.
Okay, photoelectric effect. All of you listen carefully.
Ma'am, can I start?
Yes, sure.
Good morning to all. Today I'm here to present a seminar on the topic photoelectric effect. What do you mean by photoelectric effect? It is a phenomenon of ejection of electrons from the surface of a metal when light of suitable frequency strikes it. When a light of suitable frequency strikes a metal surface, electrons are ejected from the surface of the metal, and this phenomenon is known as photoelectric effect. And the ejected electrons are called photoelectrons. In this diagram, the black represents a metal surface and this red is the incident light. When this light strikes on the metal surface, electrons are ejected from the surface. And the ejected electrons are known as photoelectrons. This blue color represents the ejected electrons. Now, this is an experimental setup for the explanation of the photoelectric effect. Here you can see that there is a vacuum tube present over here. There is no gas molecules present inside it. And on the top, there is a transparent sheet for allowing the light to pass through. On the right, there is a metal surface, and on the left, there is a detector. This detector is directly connected to the ammeter, and ammeter is directly connected to the positive terminal of the battery, and the metal surface is directly connected to the negative terminal of the battery. When we look, we can see that there is no direct connection between the positive and negative terminal, that is between the metal surface and detector, and hence the current does not flow and the ammeter doesn't show any reading. But when we allow the light to pass through this transparent sheet, we can see that the ammeter starts to show reading. So what we can understand from this? We can understand that when the light strikes on the metal surface, current is produced and electron starts flowing. This the direction of the current is from positive terminal to the negative terminal, and hence the direction of electrons will be just opposite to that of the direction of current, that is from negative terminal to positive terminal. When the light strikes on the metal surface, the electrons starts flowing, and hence the connection is made. The ammeter starts to show a reading, and the ammeter reading depends on the light. We can understand that this electricity is not immediately or originated suddenly. The electricity was already present from the battery. The thing is that earlier there was no connection between the positive and negative terminal, but when the light strikes on the metal surface, current starts flowing, and hence the connection is made. Now we want to know that if any light hits the metal, will the metals let electrons to flow? No. For this, the metal surface should be replaced by a metal that can allow the electricity, or that can let the electrons freely. So what kind of metals are those? These metals are present in the S block, in the first, that too in the first group. And these are the metals with larger or greater radius. And examples of such metals are potassium, rubidium, cesium, etc. Now we can learn how these electrons are flowing. If the frequency of the light coming is mu, then the energy of this coming light will be h nu. If this h nu energy radiation strikes on the metal surface, then the electrons absorb this energy and use this energy to move. Now we can move on to the conditions for photoelectric effect to take place. There are mainly two conditions. The first one is threshold energy, and the second one is threshold frequency. Starting with the first one, threshold energy. We want to understand that it is not compulsory that electrons will be ejected if any radiation comes. This coming light should have the minimum energy or ability to take the electrons out of the metals. So the minimum amount of energy that is required to eject an electron from the surface of a metal is called threshold energy or photoelectric work function. The threshold energy is always greater than or equal to the rest of the energy of the desired particle. And threshold energy work function equal to threshold energy. Now we can look an example. If 1000 joules is the energy required to take the electrons out of the metal, and if the energy of the coming light is only 700 joules, then this light will not be able to take the electrons out of the metal surface. Let's see another example. If 700 joules is the required energy, and if the energy of the coming light is 800 joules, then only 700 energy is required to take the electrons out of the metal. The balance 100, that is 800 minus 700 joule, 100 joule, is used by the electrons to move from one place to, that is from negative to positive terminal. And this 100 joule is known as the kinetic energy. Kinetic energy is the energy produced when the electrons move. We have already learned that if the energy of the frequency of the coming light is nu, then its energy will be h nu. And this h nu energy, when striking on the metal surface, the electrons absorb this energy and use this energy to move. So kinetic energy is h nu minus h nu zero. H nu means it is the energy of the coming light, and h nu zero is the required energy. Here energy of coming light is 800 joule, and the required energy is only 700 joule. So 800 minus 700, 100. If instead of this 800 joule it is 1000 joule, then it will, kinetic energy will be 1000 minus 700, that is 300 joule. So kinetic energy is h nu minus h nu zero. Half MeV square equal to h nu minus h nu zero, and moving this half and MeV square to the other side, we get V square equal to 2 into h nu minus h nu zero by Me, and V equal to root of 2 into h nu minus h nu zero by Me. By taking h as common, 2 into root of 2 into h nu minus h nu zero by Me. Now let's see another example. If 700 joule is the required energy, and if the energy of the coming light is 1000 joule, then what will be the kinetic energy? Kinetic energy is the energy of the coming light minus required energy. Can someone say?
300.
Yes, 300. Yeah. Kinetic energy is 1000 joule minus 700 joule, that is 300. If instead of this 1000 joule it is 2000 joule, then kinetic energy will be 2000 minus 700 joule, that is 1300. Therefore, we can say that kinetic energy is directly proportional to the frequency of radiation. We have seen here that when the frequency of radiation, that is the energy of the coming light, increases, then the kinetic energy also increases. As we have seen, by taking 2000 instead of 1000, the kinetic energy again increased to greater value. And if you are taking less value of than 1000, then kinetic energy reduces. So kinetic energy is directly proportional to the frequency of radiation. Now we can learn threshold frequency. Threshold frequency is a minimum frequency of incident light which can cause emission of photoelectrons from the metal surface. That is, if the frequency of the coming light is more than the threshold frequency, then the ejection of electron takes place. But if the frequency of the coming radiation is less than the threshold frequency, then ejection of electrons doesn't take place. Photo emission of electrons is not possible below threshold frequency. Now let's see the experimental results observed after this photoelectric effect. The first one is that when a beam of light falls on a metal surface, electrons are ejected immediately. What it means by this is that there is no time lag between the striking of the light on the metal surface and the ejection of these electrons. Soon after the light strikes on the metal surface, electrons are ejected immediately. The second point is that number of electrons ejected is proportional to the intensity or brightness of light. So depending upon the intensity, the number of electrons increases or decreases. If the intensity is more, then the number of electrons ejected will be more. And if the intensity is less, then the number of electrons ejected will also reduces. Intensity means the thickness of light. Now, the third point is that the maximum kinetic energy of emitted photoelectrons is directly proportional to the frequency of incident radiation, but independent of its intensity. This point we have seen earlier as the kinetic energy, as the frequency of the coming light increases, the kinetic energy also increases. And the last point is that number of electrons emitted per unit time depends upon the intensity and not on the frequency. The number of electrons emitted is directly proportional to the intensity, and the frequency of the light is directly proportional to the
kinetic energy. That's it.
Thank you.
Yamaharin, you had presented it well. Okay. I think more explanation for given for this topic. Okay. Congratulations. Okay. Anyone, any doubt in this topic? I think now it's more clear for you. Right? Any doubt, children?
No, ma'am.
Nothing. Right? Marin, do you want to ask any question to anyone regarding the topic?
No, ma'am.
Nothing. Okay. Then anyone else ready for the seminar, children? Abhinav, are you ready?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay. Then you can present it.
Ma'am, can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Good morning. I am going to take a seminar on J.J. Thomson's atomic model. J.J. Thomson's atomic model, or also called as plum pudding model. Thomson atomic model was proposed by William Thomson in the year 1900. This model explains the description of an inner structure of an atom at the atom theoretically. And it was also supported by Sir Joseph Thomson, who discovered the electron earlier. And during the cathode ray tube experiment, a negatively charged particle was discovered by J.J. Thomson. The experiment took place in the year 1897. The cathode ray tube is a vacuum tube, and the negative particle was called as electron. Thomson assumed that an electron is 2000 times lighter than a proton, and believed that the atom is made up of thousands of electrons. And in this atomic structure model, he considered atoms surrounded by a cloud having positive as well as negative charges. The demonstration of the ionization of air by X-ray was also done by him together with Rutherford. They were the first to demonstrate it. Thomson's atomic model was similar to a plum pudding model. We can also call Thomson's model as also a plum pudding model. And next topic is postulates of Thomson's atomic model. First postulate is that an atom consists of a positive charged sphere with electron embedded in it. You can see the picture begin here. An atom is a ball is electrically neutral. Ball is a neutral because of the negative and the positive charges are equal in the magnitude. Both are positive and negative charges are equal, so the atom is in Thomson's atomic model is compared to watermelon. Watermelon seeds are as negatively charged particle. In a watermelon, watermelon seeds are considered as negatively charged particles, and the red part of the watermelon is positively charged. Means the seeds are considered here as the negative charged particles, and the red part you can see here, it's considered as a positive charge. And next topic is that limitations of Thomson's atomic model. The limitations are that it failed to explain the stability of an atom. Because of his model of atom, failed to explain how the positive charge holds the negatively charged electrons in an atom. Therefore, the theory also failed to account the position of nucleus in an atom. The main disadvantage is that he failed to explain the stability of an atom, and because of that, it failed to account for the position of the nucleus in an atom. And next limitation is Thomson's model failed to explain the scattering of alpha particles by thin metal foils. And another limitation is that no experimental evidence in its support, means there was no experimental evidence for this model. And although the Thomson's model was not an accurate model to account for the atomic structure, it proved that it to be the base for the development of other models, like other models like Bohr's model, Rutherford's Lyard models. This was the Thomson's atomic model was the base for that. It proved that it is the base for the development of other atomic model. And the study of an atom and its structure has paved the way for the numerous inventions that have played a significant role in the development of mankind. Thomson's atomic model has made a significant role in making inventions that improved the lives of humankind. Thank you.
Yeah, Abhinav, you also presented it well. Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes. Do you have any doubts, children? Anyone? Nothing, right? Abhinav, do you want to ask any question? Abhinav?
Yes, ma'am.
Do you want to ask any question?
No. Yes, ma'am. One.
Okay, you can ask.
John Jones.
Yes.
Who discovered electrons? J.J. Thomson.
Is it correct, Abhinav? Abhinav?
Yes.
Is it correct? Yes, right? Yes, okay. Then anyone else? Sara, are you there? Then Aditya Dev will present on the next day, right?
Uh-huh.
Yes. Then one more remaining. Who is that? All of you, please switch on your videos. Okay, just message me. Okay. Okay, then we are moving to our topic. Next one is Bohr's model of an atom. Before that, did you read the portions that we had discussed in the last class, children? Do you have any doubt? Anyone? Nothing, right? Which are the different types of series obtained from hydrogen? Shabarinath, can you tell me which are the different types of series?
And those five series.
Yeah.
Lyman. Balmer.
Yeah.
Passion.
Bracket. Yeah.
Fun.
Okay. So that's about the different series that obtained from atom of hydrogen. Okay. Then we are moving to the next topic, that is Bohr's model. That is Bohr's model of an atom. Niels Bohr postulated, or Niels Bohr formulated, this Bohr model of an atom, and it was based on Planck's quantum theory. It was based on Planck's quantum theory. Clear? Niels Bohr formulated this Bohr's model for hydrogen atom, especially hydrogen atom, and for other elements also. Then he used Planck's quantum theory for the explanation for this Bohr's model. Do you remember Planck's quantum theory? Alavika, can you tell me Planck's quantum theory?
Matter radiates, or it absorbs energy in discrete quantities, or in discontinuous manner.
Then what about the equation E equal to?
Equal to h nu.
Very good. E equal to h nu. Then we are moving to the postulates of this Bohr's model of atom. Postulates of Bohr's model of atom. The first one, electrons in hydrogen atom revolve around the nucleus only in certain selected circular paths of fixed radius and definite energy. These paths are called orbits or energy shells or energy levels. From the Rutherford's model itself, he explained that there are certain electrons, they are revolving around the nucleus in certain circular paths, right? So here it's explained in detail, the electrons in hydrogen atom revolve around the nucleus only in certain circular paths of fixed radius. Okay, fixed radius from the nucleus and definite energy. And these paths are called orbits or energy levels or energy shells. Okay, these different paths are known as orbits or energy levels or energy shells. They have definite energy and fixed radius. So that's the first postulate of Bohr's model of an atom. Electrons in hydrogen atom revolve around the nucleus only in certain selected circular paths of fixed radius and definite energy. These paths are called orbits or energy levels or energy shells. We can number it as 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. Okay, first orbit or first energy level, first energy shell, 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. And we can represent it in terms of alphabet, K shell, then L shell, M shell, N shell, etc. Clear? We can number it as 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. Then we can also express it in the alphabetic form, that is K shell, L shell, M shell, N shell, etc. Okay, so the first shell that is near to the nucleus, it is K shell. First shell that is near to the nucleus, it is known as K shell. Then the outer shell is known as L shell, like that. K, L, M, N. Then the second postulate, the energy of an electron in the orbit does not change with time. Okay, the energy of an electron in the orbit does not change with time. As long as electron remains in a particular orbit, it does not lose or gain energy. Therefore, these orbits are called stationary states. They are in a state of rest. Okay, so they do not absorb or radiate energy. The energy of an electron in the orbit does not change with time. As long as electron remains in a particular orbit, it does not lose or gain energy. Therefore, these orbits are called stationary states. They are in rest. They remain stationary. That's why they are known as stationary states. Clear? So that's the second postulate. Children, please switch on your videos. Just 1 minute. So that's about the two postulates of Bohr's model of atom. Shall I move to next one, children? Have you completed?
No, ma'am.
Okay, okay. Niranjan, can you please read these two postulates?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
The Bohr's model of an atom. The electrons in the hydrogen atom revolve around the nucleus only in certain selected circular paths of fixed radius and definite energy.
Yeah.
These paths are called orbits of energy shells or energy levels. The energy of an electron in the orbit does not change with time. As long as electron remains in a particular orbit, it does not lose or gain energy. Therefore, these orbits are called stationary.
States, okay. Alandina, can you repeat it once again?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
The Bohr's model of atom. The electrons in hydrogen atom revolve around the nucleus only in certain selected circular paths of fixed radius and definite energy. These paths are called orbits or energy shells or energy levels.
Yes.
The energy of an electron in the orbit does not change with time. Mm-hmm. As long as electron remains in particular orbit, it does not lose or gain energy. Therefore, these orbits are called stationary states.
Okay. Shall I move to next one, children? Adulya, finished?
Yes.
Okay. Then the third one. Third postulate of Bohr's model of an atom. Only those orbits are permitted in which the angular momentum that can be represented as MVR, okay, in which the angular momentum of an electron is a whole number multiple of h by 2 pi. Okay, only those orbits. There is certain rule for the orbits in which the angular momentum MVR of an electron, it's a whole number multiple of h by 2 pi. So the equation is MVR equal to nh by 2 pi. The orbits that can able to obey this rule, that is MVR equal to nh by 2 pi, those orbits are permitted in this Bohr's model of an atom. And n stands for 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. That means whole numbers. Clear? Angular momentum that should be equal to the whole number multiple of h by 2 pi. That is MVR equal to nh by 2 pi. N stands for 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. Whole numbers. So all these orbits should follow this rule. Angular momentum should be equal to the whole number multiples of h by 2 pi. H by 2 pi is a constant value and it is varied along with different n values depending upon the energy level, orbit or shell. And the fourth one, we already learned that when an electron remains in its orbit itself, it is in a stationary state. That means no energy is absorbed or radiated, right? But when energy is emitted or absorbed, only when the electrons jump from one energy level to another. If one electron is in n equal to 1, that means first energy level, and this electron is jumped from this to second energy levels, electrons are emitted or absorbed. Okay. So the energy is emitted or absorbed only when the electrons jump from one energy level to another. Energy emitted or absorbed is given by the difference of energies between two energy levels are concerned. So to find out the energy emitted or absorbed by that electron, it's find out by just find out the difference between the two energies of energy levels. Okay. If they are jumping from n equal to 1 to n equal to 2, we just find out the difference between the energy of second energy level and the first one. Clear? So delta E is equal to E2 minus E1. And we have learned that delta E equal to H nu, right? According to Planck's quantum theory, delta E equal to H nu. So we substitute here H nu. So E2 minus E1 and nu is also equal to E2 minus E1 by H. Nu means frequency. From this equation, not only energy, frequency can also be obtained. So these four are the main postulates of Bohr's model of an atom. And you have to remember one more point. If an electron moves from a lower energy level to higher energy level, it should absorb energy. Okay, lower energy level to higher energy level, it should absorb energy. And if one electron is moving from higher to lower, it should emit energy. In this figure, you can clearly observe that, right? Here, this electron moves from n equal to 2 to n equal to 3. And this atom absorbs energy. Okay, atom absorbs energy. Do you remember the different energy levels and the emission and absorption spectrum related to that one? When they are in lower energy state, they need energy and they will jump to higher energy state. And this higher energy state, it is considered as an unstable state. Okay, and they will back to their ground state by releasing energy. That's it. So in the first one, it's moved from lower energy level to higher energy level. It absorbs energy. And in the second image, it's the electrons jump from higher energy level to lower energy level. Here it emits energy. Okay, emits energy. So in both cases, we just find out the energy difference by just taking the energy difference of two energy levels. Delta E is equal to E2 minus E1. And delta E is equal to H nu according to Planck's quantum theory. So we can substitute H nu instead of delta E. So H nu is equal to E2 minus E1. Then to find out nu, we just change the position of H to opposite side. H stands for?
Planck's constant.
Yeah, Planck's constant. Then what about its value? Do you remember, children?
6.62 into 10 raised to minus 3.
Very good. 6.62 into 10 raised to minus 3, 4, 34. Have you completed the four postulates of Bohr's model of an atom? All of you?
Yes.
Rose, is your device okay? Nothing, right? Oh, okay, fine. It's okay. Pooja, can you please read the third and fourth postulate? Yeah. Not audible. Try once again. Oh, very low voice. It's okay. Devika, can you please read? Devika. Devika, Elaine?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Third
and fourth one, yeah.
Only Bohr's orbit are permitted in which the angular momentum of the electron and the whole number multiple of h by 2 pi.
Yeah.
Four, the energy is emitted or absorbed only when the electron jumps from one energy level to another. Yes. Energy emitted or absorbed is given by the difference of energies between two energy levels.
Okay. The equation delta E is equal to E2 minus E1. H nu equal to E2 minus E1. So nu equal to E2 minus E1 by H. Is this clear, children? Shall I move to the applications of this Bohr's model? Okay, next one is applications of this Bohr's model. Okay, applications of this Bohr's model. So the first point, the radii. What do you mean by radii? Yeah, radius itself, right? It's a plural form. So the radii of the stationary states are expressed as Rn. Okay, R then subscript n. Rn is equal to n square a zero. Okay, the radius of stationary states are expressed as Rn. N depends on the different energy levels, 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. So Rn is equal to n square a zero, where a zero is 52.9 picometer. PM stands for picometer. Okay, and n is called principal quantum number. Or you have learned that it's energy level or shell. We will discuss about this principal quantum number in the coming portions. Okay. So the radii of the stationary states are expressed as Rn. That's the radius of nth level. And n stands for 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. Rn is equal to n square a0, where a0 is 52.9 picometer. And n is called principal quantum number or energy level. So the radius of first stationary state, that means radius of the energy level 1, that is called the Bohr orbit. And its value is 52.9 picometer itself. So because when you substitute n equal to 1, that is 1 square, 1 itself, right? So this radius or radii of this first energy level, that is equal to 52.9 picometer. Okay, 52.9 picometer. Then can you tell me what about the radius of the second one? R2 is equal to? R2 is equal to? John, can you tell me? How to find? Yeah, 4 into?
A0, 52.
What's the value? Oh, yeah, 52.9 picometer. And R3 is equal to 6 into 9 into 52.9, 3 square, right? Okay, so this is the general equation to find out the radius of each stationary state. Rn is equal to n square into a0, and the value of a0, that is 52.9 picometer. The radius of this first stationary state or first energy level, that is also equal to 52.9 picometer, and this radius is known as Bohr orbit. Bohr orbit. And the second one, the energy of electron in a stationary state is given by the expression. Do you remember this equation, children? En is equal to minus Rh into 1 by n square. Can you tell me from which part this equation is derived? Do you remember that Rydberg's equation? Okay. So En equal to minus Rh into 1 by n square. This is another equation to find out energy. We have already learned E equal to h nu, right? Then this is another equation to find out the energy. That is minus Rh into 1 by n square. Okay, minus Rh into 1 by n square. And this Rh, it stands for Rydberg's constant. And we have learned another value, right? Do you remember that one for Rydberg constant? Starting with 10.
109.10.
Yes. Yeah, that's in the unit centimeter inverse or meter inverse, right? Here it's in joule. That's why it is converted to another one. 2.18 into 10 raised to minus 18 joule. Okay, this is also Rydberg's constant. Here it is converted to joule. That's why it is 2.18 into 10 raised to minus 18 joule. Clear? And this four hydrogen-like ions. What do you mean by hydrogen-like ions? That means the number of electrons is similar to that of hydrogen. This He plus. What's the atomic number of helium? Atomic number of helium, yeah. 4, right? So here it is He plus. Plus means it lost one electron, right? It lost one electron. Sorry, it is 2. It lost one electron. So it becomes 1, right? Its atomic number is 2 and it lost one electron, it becomes 1. The next one, lithium. What about the atomic number of lithium?
3.
Then here it is Li 2 plus. That means 2 electrons lost. Then it becomes 1, right? The next one is beryllium. Its atomic number is 4. And here it is Be 3 plus. That means it lost 3 electrons. It is also equal to 1. So that's hydrogen-like ions. Atomic number of hydrogen is 1. That means number of electrons and number of protons is 1. Here in the case of this He plus, Li 2 plus, Be 3 plus, etc., the number of electrons is same. Okay. And these species are known as isoelectronic species. Just note down this isoelectronic species. That means same number of electrons. Okay, He plus, Li 2 plus, Be 3 plus, etc. They have same number of electrons. It is known as isoelectronic species. So for hydrogen-like ions, the radii is given by the expression Rn is equal to 52.9 into n square by z picometer. Only difference, it is divided by its atomic number. Z stands for atomic number. Okay, for hydrogen-like ions, the radii is given by the expression Rn is equal to 52.9 n square divided by z. We included this factor atomic number here for hydrogen-like ions. And there is one difference in the expression of energy also. En is equal to minus 2.18 into 10 raised to 18 z square by n square. Here also we included this atomic number. Okay. In the previous one, it is simply 1 by n square, right? 1 by n square. Here we included the atomic number also. Then it becomes minus 2.18 into 10 raised to minus 18 z square by n square joule. Is this clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Do you have any doubt, children? Anyone? Have you completed the slide?
No.
Okay, then I will show the slide once again in the next class. Okay, now it's time. That's why. Okay, just wait. Let me take your attendance. Okay, children. Then thank you all. See you in the next class. Samia, you can take the seminar in the next class. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you all. Bye. Have a nice day.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.